Good morning. Good morning,
Good morning,
Mark.
Matt. How are you?
I'm good, thanks. How about yourself? I was a little worried because I hear you just never express any opinions on healthcare. You have a reputation of just playing it very, very close
Very
to the
close to the
chest.
vest, yeah.
And there's
I have
nothing
my talking points right here, actually.
there's nothing happening on healthcare
No.
right now. Apparently, the latest last-ditch effort to repeal the Obamacare Affordable Care Act is seemingly dead.
Yes.
Although there's two more days,
Yeah.
anything could happen. Is it really dead?
Yes.
Yes. How do you feel about the demise of the various efforts, and Graham Cassidy in particular?
Well, I think, Senator Warner, who I have a great degree of respect for, he and I have talked a lot about this and conscious capitalism. And I think as we think about what gets done in this country of any major social import, it's always done bipartisan because no sooner is the bill passed and put into place than it needs to be fixed.
Yeah.
Medicare gets tweaked every year, Social Security gets tweaked every year, Medicaid gets tweaked every year, and you have to have a bipartisan agreement that we need to fix these things as they go along because nothing's perfect out of the box. That's what real innovation is.
But it would seem from the number of plans that have been floated and failed
Right.
over the past couple of months, it would seem that there's actually a wide area of give on healthcare. What has been, and there have been bipartisan plans hanging out there for
Right.
since the Nixon era, right?
So you have to, if you took the politics out of the situation, we'd have a bipartisan solution already.
Okay.
These are about this is about election promises and an 18 election. And if we really want to fix the thing, there are very simple, straightforward things we can do to fix it. The Affordable Care Act, which, by the way, touches really, 18 million people out of 330 million people. So if we want to fix it, we can. We just need to get people in a room that can do it. There are people who have been in the room to do it. We just need to get it to the forefront and have it done. And I think once we get past, the bewitching hour of September 30th, I think we have an opportunity to actually do something in a bipartisan way. And that would be a great start to get tax reform done in a bipartisan way and to get infrastructure done in a bipartisan way, which would invigorate our economy.
Let's talk about the Affordable Care Act for a second.
Yep.
Your company, Aetna, was it has pulled out of the exchanges for 2018. Which do you think has been a bigger problem for the Affordable Care Act this year? Has it been structural issues in the bill's design, or has it been administrative wavering from President Trump's administration over actually reimbursements
So it's
and supporting
uncertainty.
the bill?
Um, so for those of us, I'm not an actuary, but I, play one on TV. And as actuaries, we price these products 18 months in advance of the actual due date. And so if the rules are constantly changing and the funding is constantly at risk, you don't know how to price the product. That's insurance. And so if you want to deal with stabilizing the market, you need to have a stable footprint. Even under the Obama administration, there was instability in the exchanges every year because the rules had to be made up in regulation because Congress couldn't work together to change the law in legislation. Had they got added immediately, I mean, if we did not touch Medicare, Social Security, or Medicaid for 7 years, they too would fall apart. So, because we couldn't do it in legislation, HHS tried to do it in regulation, and that is a very difficult thing to do with any kind of predictability.
Did your own decision to pull out have anything to do with the government's blocking your merger with Humana earlier
No.
this year?
Nope. We still, I mean, we're still here. The Humana deal, nothing ventured, nothing gained. We thought it was a good idea. We thought it could really be powerful. It's not the end of the world. We have a great organization and great people, and we'll be fine.
Outside policy, you've got some strange ideas about healthcare, I gotta say. You come to Washington, which, they say New York is the city that never sleeps. Washington is the city with people that never sleep.
Yeah.
And you're talking, you sleep 7.5 hours a night.
Totally.
How is that
Try it,
possible?
you'll like it.
You're the CEO of a major company.
Right.
How do you sleep at 7.5 hours a night?
Well, your amount of time you spend on your work and thinking about your work is not directly related to the success of your work. Think about that.
It's too complex an idea
I mean,
for me to
people who
parse.
count garages and cars and garages at workplaces after 7 o'clock are really got it all wrong. And so you do need 7.5 hours of sleep, and what we do is we pay our employees to do it 20 nights in a row, because if you do it 20 nights in a row, you will want to keep doing it because it is so powerful. So blue light in the morning for an hour without any glass or shield over your face, outdoors, creates melatonin that gets stored for later in the evening. And in the evening, you should have yellow light or amber glasses that will allow you to ramp down as we used to around fires a long time ago, so you can sleep. Those two things, just try it. And do it 20 nights in a row, and you will feel completely different.
How did you come by these wacky out there ideas about?
Well, first of all, I had an accident. So I was one of those sleep-deprived people. I had a skiing accident, broke my neck in 5 places, oof, you know, coma for a week, lost the use of my left arm, you know, all those sorts of things, chronic neuropathy. And when you have that moment, you sort of have to say, okay, well, how can I put this all back together? And sleep was one of the big ones. I used to sleep from 11 to 1, work from 1 to 3, scare everybody at work because I sent out emails, go back to bed from 3 to 5, and then go to the gym. 4 hours of sleep a night, chronically sleep-deprived. Not making good decisions.
And how does this factor into Aetna's work? I mean, do you all do interventions with the companies that sign up with you to say?
We do. So we, you know, we offered. I came to work one day and said we should do yoga and mindfulness together as an organization. The team all groaned, and they sent the chief medical officer to me because he described that I was talking about was voodoo medicine. And we, you know, took our employees and put 790 of them through mindfulness and yoga for 12 weeks. We measured their stress levels by cortisol levels and by heart rate variability, and we saw dramatic drops. People at the highest level of stress, $2,500 a year more healthcare costs.
So are you covering like supplements,
acupuncture? All that stuff is covered, by the way, in your HSA or your HRA. If you work for an employer that allows you to put money away, you can pay for all of that stuff. That's where you can get that done. Some employers offer yoga. We now have a program called the Healthy Cities and Counties Challenge across America. We have 50 cities competing. We just launched a site today, healthycities.org, to track them over 2 years, working on violence in cities like Kansas City, urban farming in places like New York. Aetna has started 5,539 urban farm beds over the last 2 years in communities where there are food deserts. And then we announced, or Meals on Wheels announced earlier this week, that their 2 million volunteers will give us feedback on the homes of seniors they go to if the seniors' attitudes or circumstances have changed, so we can intervene at the home to help them. Because food insecurity and isolation leads to higher dementia, higher depression, higher diabetes, and higher incidence of Alzheimer's. And so we've got we're crowdsourcing social determinants of health. We're putting 2 million people into homes, and they're just going to give us the information, and we'll act on it.
I know a lot of folks who would be, I might say, concerned.
Yep.
If they heard that their insurer was sending 2 million people into their homes to gather all sorts of information about their lives. Why should we trust you?
Because it's not us doing
it.
You're
spies.
These 2 million people are people that see these people every day. So we often worry, so all of you have seen a doctor, I'm sure, at some point in the near past. You get 15 minutes. Are they talking to you about how things are going at home? How's the diet going? Exercise? Are you feeling well? Anything troubling you? You get 15 minutes. And even if they did ask you that, we lie 75% of the time. Working out 30 minutes a day, doc, I'm doing great, eating only vegetables and fruits, I'm really doing good. And so I don't drink at all. I just have a couple glasses. They're tumblers, but they have a couple glasses. And so this idea of getting away from the exam table into the kitchen table and actually understanding what's going on in the home, so Aetna can't go knock on a door and say, hey, we'd like to come for dinner. Because you learn about everything in the kitchen table. I come from an Italian family. That's where you find out everything going on in the whole family. And so if you can get to the kitchen table, you have to have people that those individuals trust. And the people that deliver food to them every day are people they trust. And those people can make honest assessments of what's going on from day to day. And that's what we want to hear. It's not that we want to intervene in their home, but if they're isolated, if they're not getting enough food, if they have a problem with, you know, travel and getting their meds, we want to know about it because it's cheaper for us to pay for Uber, to pay for a ramp out in front of the house, to pay for fuel assistance, to pay for Meals on Wheels, if we can indeed know that that's there, because it's cheaper for doing that than for them to show up at one ER visits.
The points that you're making don't tie back, obviously, to our big conversation about the Affordable Care Act and federal health care. Mm-hmm. We spend a lot of time talking about pre-existing conditions and whether or not they're going to be mandated for coverage. How do we create a federal system that would pay for my Uber, for example?
So what we need to do is we need to liberalize the definition of benefits. So every state categorizes what benefits should be covered under health care reform. And instead, what we should say is a healthy person is productive. A productive person is viable socially, spiritually, economically, physically, and viable people are happy. And if we need to provide a service that can allow us to do that, we should do that. We should intervene. And so when you look at the total spend on health and social determinants across the OECD nations, the United States, when you add the two together, is now 11th. Our value for services rendered across that spectrum is 34 out of 34th. Our life expectancy's gone down for the first time. And when you look at the split between healthcare and social determinants, the United States is the only country that spends more than 40% on healthcare. We spend 64%. So we've got it wrong, and it's showing up in our emergency rooms. It's showing up with opioid addiction and overdoses, which will be 70,000 overdoses this year, more than automobile accidents, gunshot wounds, and suicides put together. We have a pandemic. It's bigger than diabetes because people have lost hope, and it's because of where they live.
When you say liberalize the definition of health, though, part of what I hear is, oh, let's not mandate a definition of what constitutes a health condition. Is that what you are saying?
Personalized medicine dictates that we understand what, for you, what does your health do to get in the way of the life you want to lead? And we need to make that work for you, because that's the only way we're going to engage you. If I start talking about pedal neuropathy for diabetics, and that you could, with pre-diabetes, be a type 2 diabetic in 7 years, you're going to go, that's what you tell your doctor, right? Thanks, doc. Appreciate it. I'll work hard on it. But if you have pedal neuropathy, and we say, if we get your feet better, and you can go for a walk to the senior center, or you can take your children, grandchildren, for a walk in the park like you used to, you've got my attention. Because now you've eliminated a barrier for me. People think of their health as a barrier to the life they want to lead, not the condition they have.
Let's talk about who pays for, and who actually pays for my Uber, in this case, for a moment. I've heard mixed things. Senator Sanders' push for a single payer healthcare, Medicaid for all. Medicare for all, sorry. What do you actually feel about that idea, and the idea of single payer more broadly?
I think the idea of financing a broken system is like financing a bad car. No matter how you finance a bad car, you get a bad car, right?
Okay.
So if you paid for it with cash, or you took a loan, or if you think about it, nobody goes to General Motors Acceptance Corporation to buy a car. And insurance companies are the GMAC of healthcare. We finance healthcare. Nobody can go to General Motors, knock on their front door, and get a car. You have to go to a dealership, and you have to talk about your ambitions for transportation. You have to talk about what you need. And then when you understand that investment, then you finance it. And so what we're talking about with the Affordable Care Act, and one of the reasons it hasn't reduced costs, why we talk about single payer, like we talk about Graham Lindsay, all of it is focused on financing of healthcare. None of it's focused on the underlying costs of healthcare, which is a bad investment. When the IOM, Institutes of Medicine, a bunch of doctors, say 30% of the $3 trillion spent on healthcare, $900 billion, is wasted, there's your financing. There's $900 billion. Let's go get that. Let's do the right thing.
But if Graham Cassidy were to have succeeded, it would have created 50 different healthcare systems all over the country. And it would be very difficult to get from that system, wouldn't it, to one where the ideas that you've put in place are accessible to all Americans?
Well, if you look at Canada has a federal financing of each province and territory designing the budget for their healthcare delivery. That was Graham Cassidy in a lot of ways.
Interesting. Right?
So the Canadian healthcare system budgets by territory and province for the healthcare that they're going to do, and they're responsible for delivery, just like that would have supposed our states. And then you got the federal government with the financing of it through taxes. So, you know, people point and go, oh, no, we can't do that. Well, that's what they're doing north of the border.
All right, simple question. You've got 1 minute. I want you to redesign the U.S. healthcare system from ground up. What does it look like?
So what we would do, and this is what we're trying to do with the Healthiest Cities and Counties Challenge, is what we would do is we would understand the demography, disease burden, social and economic patterns of a community. And we would say, okay, what does the system need to be like to support that? Central Kentucky has some of the highest opioid addiction in America. We're handing out Narcan to first responders to teach them how to use it. So if we understand that demography and that disease burden, then we can design a system that works for that community, and then we can deliver that to the community in the most efficient way possible. That's the investment. Understand the investment and then finance it. We'll save money. And so if you think about that from the context of, you know, how we revolutionize the system, right now our governance model on healthcare at a federal level and a state level is not big enough and not robust enough to manage the economy of healthcare, which is now 17, pick your number, 18% of the GDP of this country. And so when we run into issues where our governance models in our companies, in our governments, in our economies are not sufficient to govern properly, then you have people saying, well, we need a new world order, because, right, we're social ecosystems. I would argue it's the exact opposite. You have to go back to community. You have to go back local, and you have to be in the community, in the neighborhoods, talking to people about what matters, and do it for them, not because we have some idea of the idealistic version of health and how it all ought to work from a national level by pushing a button. It doesn't work that way.
What are you watching next? What do you think is the very next move that we should be paying attention to right now?
In healthcare?
Yes, in the argument over what
I think there's bipartisan work going on. I know that for a fact. I've spent time with senators who are working on it. I think that will be the next step. I think we just got to continue to support a bipartisan solution, because bipartisan solutions can be touched every year, and they can be fixed, and they can be tweaked, because it's a joint effort for the American people. When it's not bipartisan, that's when things blow up.
All right.
All right.
Mark Bartolini,
thank you
very
Matt.
Much.